Have you been watching the Olympics? Don't watch it. All right, just don't watch it. Don't watch it. Because you know by not watching it, you're going to bypass a lot of subliminal stuff. It's an attempt to mass hypnotize the consciousness of the world. So much embedded stuff, so much subliminal stuff that's been going on for a long, long time. Watch. That's easy. Here we have an alternative which is more interesting, called the Spiritual Olympics. There are two different paradigms of spiritual talk these days. And one says that they both agree that there is a great deal of trouble coming up and challenge, etc. One says that there's a way to move past this. And another says that it's even beyond moving past it. You simply realize that the dream has no consequences on reality, never could have any consequences on it. And so it's as if it's completely inconsequential. Doesn't matter what happens. And paradoxically, it would seem that this attitude of being completely unconcerned about what happens is the most potent of them all. Because the plan, again, is for total loss to take place. And this total loss will then result in a new creation, as it were. First of all, a total loss cannot take place. It's impossible. Again, I've been down that road, know what the outcome is. It is simply a symbolic total chaos. Total chaos. It's only symbolized, and it doesn't result in anything. So it's a waste of time. Attempt total loss, attempting for total loss is just a waste of time. And we hear that the dark forces, the negative energies, those who are trying to separate from God are trying to bring about this total loss. Okay. They are trying. But this whole dream of existence is actually trying that, which is, at least that is what I believe. Because you can't have loss without first having something that can be lost, right? Now, the other way is to say that nothing real can be threatened and nothing unreal exists. Therein lies the peace of God. And so a dream is threatening itself, so to speak. A dream is threatening itself with annihilation. Should we really be concerned, is the question. This is really a crucial, and it's one, worth, very much worth considering, because it's hard to resolve this. We are told that if this planet gets out of whack, it affects other planets, which affects the galaxy, solar system, galaxy, and it affects everything. Everything that happens affects everything else. So everything is vulnerable, in other words. Then we're also told that nothing is vulnerable, that in reality there's no vulnerability whatsoever. Nothing real is threatened. So you have sort of an agreement that there is an attempt to planetary sacrifice. There most definitely is. And there's a bit of disagreement on what to do about it. Should we? So this is topic for legitimate discourse, better than watching the Olympics. And there are some who want to create a new scenario as a way of sidestepping the problems, and there are others who feel that simply remembering what they really are, remembering reality as it really is the best way. And don't try to oppose anything that's going on. You see, there are some similarities and there's some differences. It would sure be nice if we had a complete clarification of this, because it's easy to cross-pollinate these two ways of looking at things, the situation. My basic intuition is that is to believe that nothing real can be threatened and nothing unreal exists. That there is no threat to reality whatsoever, none. That's my basic take. My basic take also is that existence, the manifestation of existence, including the whole universe, is a dream. It's not real. And so all the vulnerability within this dream is only a dream, illusions being vulnerable to other illusions. Now, the dream does have dynamics in it that we call energy. And that energy can be, quote-unquote, misused according to the laws of energy. But the question is energy a creation of the prime creator, really? My belief is that reality is essence, which is non-polarized. There's no polarity to it. It's different than energy. It's isness. It's pure isness, pure nowness, and completely invulnerable, cannot be changed, and it's different than energy, entirely different. We can't even imagine it, really. You have to experience isness. You have to experience essence. No possibility of essence being harmed in any way. And it is simple, 100% present, and without any possibility that could ever be not present. And the experience of reality is like a flow through essence in multidimensional ways, even infinitely dimensional ways, where you simply, there's no end to the tapestry of the flow that you can experience. You can either have a lot or a little, fast or slow. And we're not a person, we're not a body, we're not a thing. We seem to be the locus through which the tapestry flows and then outflows. It's almost, it's not possible to you can kind of imagine it in a certain way, but the richness of it is beyond belief, because there are flows within flows within flows within flows, and we simply, whatever, however we want to navigate this flow, we're able to just spontaneously navigate it and adjust it, and it's just it's beyond anything that's in the existence or in the universe, really. Because there's no question of balance or harmony or anything like that. It's impossible. Everything is already 100% what it is. It's isness, is truth, endlessness, permanence. You know, all these things are replied to all, and so there's no possibility of any concern arising in any way about anything. And existence is a dream of loss that is trying to present an alternative to the reality of essence by using energy. Now, that is what I've always believed. And I know that there are those who see the manifest existence as part of the one's prime creator's output, and that it's threatened, that it can be somehow undone. And it's very difficult to get a final answer on this. And I really would like to have one, because there's some very brilliant people in different directions saying various things. But consider that those who want to so-called create a negative outcome, they depend on belief, a certain belief that people are vulnerable. And if we can bring in the presence of total unconcern, that would just simply completely freak out those who are attempting to bring about, you know, massive loss. Because those who have no concern whatsoever about loss at all, who just laugh at the notion with no concern, they have complete reassurance that reality cannot be touched. Just imagine what that could do to those whose whole purpose is the belief that reality can be destroyed. You know, that would just cause them to leap back in terror, you know, like, oh my gosh, I don't dare go here because there's nothing to work with. There's nothing to work with here. To them, it's like an annihilation. So I would say, A Course in Miracles says that defenselessness, our safety lies in complete defenselessness. Why? Because those who believe in destruction look at complete defenselessness as their own annihilation. And so they will stay far away from possible as that. They will flee. They will head for the hills. They don't. That's the last thing they want to encounter. What they want to encounter is those who believe that their plans could succeed. You know, resistance. Resistance simply feeds their belief that what they're doing is real. So somehow it, you know, empowers it. But no resistance. I remember Jesus taught, turn the other cheek, love your enemy. Okay, that's no resistance. And then he says that our perfect strength is found in perfect defenselessness. Because you're literally affirming the fact that reality is not threatened in any way. It can never be. So those who want to threaten reality, they can't stand this knowing this. They, to them, it's like you're a black hole. It's like you're a black hole. Yeah, and they don't want to go near that black hole, because all their plans will just dissolve into complete irrelevancy, you know, and they'll think they have lost. So to really be safe is to give up all defensiveness entirely and realize you don't need to do anything. And then you will be truly, truly safe. So that is what A Course in Miracles, to the best of my understanding, teaches, what I see clearly. On the other hand, there some do see it as in a slightly different way, that there needs to be a change, a shifting, sidestepping of the situation indeed. But the ultimate sidestep would be to simply realize that there's no need to sidestep anything at all. It's kind of like in a dream when you've got this bully chasing you and they're closing in on you. You know, and they're getting bigger and bigger, closer and closer. What if you just suddenly said, ah, this is a dream. I'm just going to wake up from the dream. Poof. No more bully. You didn't do anything. But what about if you stay in the dream and you say, okay, I'm going to make this really clever way of tricking the bully. And I'm going to go over here. See, the bully's aware. It says, ah. You know, they're doing something here. They're resisting. They think they can defeat me. And so the bully thinks, oh, I must be bullying them. You know, the dream kind of feeds off itself, really. Really, the dream of existence feeds off itself like that. But if you simply just got to remember, nothing happened in the dream. No outcome is needed in a dream. No outcome is needed in a dream. None. So there's that type of teaching. And that's what I've been teaching. But I do agree that these times are extremely, extremely important, because if you're not aware this is a dream, then you are going to be confronted with those who want to make this dream permanent, okay? And that does entail tremendous suffering and loss, etc. The attempt to make impermanence permanent is a very nasty attempt. That is true. That entails pulling a lot down into a veritable, you know, black hole, as it were, of loss, of endless loss, and ultimately chaos. And the experience of chaos is indeed the worst experience there is. It's a feeling of no control whatsoever. Not only no control, but no possibility of ever establishing control. And I've literally been through that experience. I know exactly what it's like. And it is indeed terrible. But I found out that from there's nowhere to go but up. You know, there's nowhere to go except to realize that this is all a dream eventually, because this is the goal of this dream. And what I saw was there are two options. Either you gradually work towards remembering what you really are and awaking from this dream, or you leap directly back into reality. And I saw it's possible to leap directly back into reality, but I also saw it seems to be a break in continuity from a point of feeling no control, total chaos, and no way of ordering this chaos at all. From there to leap back into total control, which is reality. Total control. You're completely in control of your experiencing. Completely. With no possibility that it ever be otherwise. It's completely spontaneous. It's beyond what we can even imagine. I've experienced it for a moment. And the spontaneous creativity, it is just incredible. It's beautiful. It's just rich. So to go from one extreme to the other seems like too much of a break in continuity. So we decide to take a gradual path of awakening, so to speak. Now, it is possible on that gradual path to awakening, it is possible that we could benefit from certain situations. That's possible. So I'm not disregarding the idea of imagining a better existence or something. Because it's either that or awaken from the dream. It's one of the two. You certainly don't want to imagine a worse existence. No. But at the same time, if you say, well, imagine what you want. Well, I want reality. I want a complete loss-free experience. Zero maintenance. Zero vulnerability. And et cetera, et cetera. Anything other than that, I don't even want it at all. So it is possible that there are those who are not yet ready to realize the whole thing. They still see some value in the universe, so they want to sidestep the plan of total loss. I call it planetary sacrifice, is what really what's going on. That is true. Very nasty, beyond our imagining. That is true. But those are all the workings of dream figures in a dream. They have no consequence on reality. But Without seeing that, one will then automatically try to sidestep it by certain ways. And maybe that's appropriate for them, because they're not ready to, again, drop the entire dream, okay? But in my case, I feel ready to drop the whole dream. And so, but again, there's nothing more potent than that. That completely pulls the rug out from under those who are trying to bring about total loss. Which is what Jesus really did. He said, "You want to crucify me? Go ahead." It's no loss. And the martyrs of the early church said, "You want to sacrifice my body? It's nothing to me. It doesn't cause the slightest problem for me. It's no loss." And gradually through this attitude that Jesus brought in, it freaked out the dark ones, the ones who are trying to bring out total loss, trying to bring about total destruction. Ancient Rome was a very nasty place. Ancient times there, and it's coming back now, exponentially. And they couldn't take it. They couldn't take it. They absolutely couldn't take it. It freaked them out. As Jesus just said, there's no such thing as loss. Not in an energetic sense, but in the real sense, nothing real can be threatened. And nothing unreal exists. So it caused a disintegration of the Roman Empire, really. And it brought about positive changes for the world. So just one being here who is completely unconcerned about any outcomes is the most potent force there is. All outcomes in a dream are equally important. There's a way of putting it, okay? If there is one being here who not just says that I'm saying it, which is something, but who knows it beyond the slightest doubt and is simply radiating that assurance, all outcomes in a dream are equally unimportant. That simply diffuses the whole situation, really. I mean, it causes those who believe in loss to just throws them for a loop entirely. Because they want to believe that outcomes are important, That's totally key. They want to take people who believe outcomes are important and then destroy them, so to speak, to create their loss, Loss. In order for loss to have meaning, it has to be loss of something, right? If there's loss of nothing, how is that meaningful? Loss of nothing has what meaning? But if you realize that dreams are nothing, illusions are nothing, what meaning can loss have for at all? So just one being here in this world like that, oh my gosh, the darkness will flee, really. they'll get out of the way. They don't want to come across that at all. That's like kryptonite. Kryptonite, total kryptonite. And not that they're being targeted in any way. It doesn't matter. Outcomes in a dream don't matter at all to reality. So, therefore, just drop the whole thing right now. Again, in order for loss to have meaning, it has to be a loss of something. So it has to be, first there has to be those who believe that they can lose something precious and they got to hold on to it. And then someone comes along and dispossesses them of that. And then they feel this great sense of loss, like it's very important. They've lost something very important. And then those who caused the loss can feel real powerful and say, "Yeah, you see, I got this power to bring about loss." But, see, it has to be loss of something. But if you have the attitude of loss of nothing is not a loss, the loss of loss is not a loss either. then it's kind of like they say, party poop. Now the game can continue, but for you it doesn't have to. But you know, they kind of want to, they'll walk away in disgust. Yeah, you don't want to play the game of loss. Be mad about that. In order to play the game of loss, you have to have those who have something that they feel is valuable, but it can be lost. And then the game commences without that first. In other words, if you want to play the game of the fear of the universe being destroyed, first you have to have a universe there, right? That's the game of loss. It's the dance of Maya, the dance of duality. If you want to play the game of destroying reality, first you have to simulate reality. You have to symbolize it. There's a whole universe. Okay, there it is. First, it's got to be there, and then you can move in on it and try and destroy it somehow. But if you just say, ah, go ahead, do whatever you want to do, it doesn't make any difference. No results in a dream have any consequence whatsoever. If that true truth is simply there, pure, that pure truth is there, then, you know, just completely deflating. It is completely deflating. So if we really want to deflate the problems, the problems that are coming, all this trouble, that attitude is the best attitude. Just this pure abidance in truth, completely deflating. Especially to those who are into loss. Might be somewhat deflating to those who are into defeating loss, because then they don't have anything to defeat. If loss gets deflated, they don't have anything to defeat. But yeah, it causes just complete deflation. Yeah, that. So I do see that intuitively as the true remedy. And yet it hasn't happened. But they do say, I have heard it said, that if just one being on this planet embodied pure truth, that would literally save the planet, could save the planet, as it were, so to speak. I don't know if that's true or not. And by save the planet, I mean deflate the whole play of loss, because they just would feel, nah, I'm not going to bite into this, you know, there's something here I can't digest. Cannot digest it at all. The belief in loss cannot digest this attitude, this truth that loss is impossible, and there's no need for any defense. Reality doesn't need any defense. Reality has no defense. Doesn't need it. And all outcomes in a dream are equally meaningless. So just this attitude, outcomes don't matter at all in a dream. You want loss? Fine. There's no difference one way or the other. It makes no difference. That just like stops loss in its tracks, because loss wants loss to mean something. It wants it to mean that loss of something valuable, something real. If loss is not of something real, how can it be loss at all? You see? But if the attitude is just like, sure, take it all. Take the whole universe. Doesn't bother me the slightest bit. Go ahead. You know, and it's pure. It's not just a bluff. It's pure. Then loss will just stagger back and say, oh my, because it's horrible. This one doesn't see anything real in the universe, no value whatsoever. So how can loss have any meaning at all? Can't have any meaning. And they will flee far away from that. Let me adjust this. As the light changes, What's that super? As the world changes. As the world changes, yeah. As the world changes, nothing changes really. So that there is that perspective. I respect other perspectives too, because it's not easy to get this entirely clear, because it's almost like mixed messages have been sent here. I just pray that you know, we get a definitive answer for this. And it is possible, again, for this attitude of unconcern to come into the world. Because again, Ananda Maima, I know for a fact, had this attitude of total unconcern. Come what may, she says, nothing bothers me. She goes, even though the entire universe swirls and dances and changes, but I am doesn't change in the slightest bit. I'm totally unconcerned about anything that happens in the universe. It was truly her attitude. But she also understood that there seems to be a need to for some modifications of the dream to help people spiritually in some way. I'm not entirely clear about that. You know, that's very sophisticated stuff. But for sure, the unconcern, if you truly, that is truly expressed here in its complete purity. Oh boy, you know, what an effect that has. We don't know what the effects of these great teachers has been throughout history, but just bringing that total unconcern, that probably has a tremendous effect on all the attempts at loss, because who is going to attempt loss if they can feel that it's meaningless, entirely meaningless? Who's going to attempt it? They're going to go somewhere else. They're going to say, hey, I don't want to be here on this planet. Nobody even cares about loss. It's nothing to them. Why should I even come here? You know, let's go somewhere where people really will fight us and resist us. Jesus said, resist not evil. Okay? That is a profound, profound teaching, which is exactly what's being said, emphasized here. Resist not evil. As soon as you resist evil, that's exactly what evil wants. Because then they say, aha, these people fear loss. They must have something that is valuable to lose. So they're going to go after you then. Whereas if you say, I don't have anything to lose, whatever, take it all. Doesn't bother me in the slightest bit. Doesn't affect what I am in the slightest bit. Loss in a dream is meaningless. That realization of that, then those who want loss will just turn around and say, ah, there's nothing here. Nothing here. Let's go. Nothing here. Let's go. Because loss would be meaningless to them. And what they want is a meaningful loss. A meaningless loss is nothing. So they want loss that's meaningful. They want people to, they want to engage with a fight. They want to fight. They want to fight. I think, who was it? Peter picked up a sword in the Garden of Gethsemane and hacked off the centurion's ear. And Jesus said, what are you doing? Put the sword down. Don't resist. Don't fight. No. That's not what I came to teach you at all. Resist not evil. That's the way. That's the true way. So we do have that tradition. Resist not evil. And it is a very interesting tradition, right? And I know we have our space brothers giving us a lot of information. Their information on the attempt at loss, I think, is very accurate. Okay, I don't disagree with that at all. Very accurate. Some of them, talking about the potential for troubles here and planetary sacrifice, is very, very true. I'm not sure about their remedy, though. I'm not sure. I would say it seems to me that Jesus' remedy is the true one. Resist not evil. Unconditional love. That which cannot be lost. Be in a condition of unconditional love And you know that that unconditional love cannot lose itself. Nothing that can be lost there. It's not possible. And therefore, the ones who want a meaningful loss will just see you as nothing. Bypass you. They'll bypass you. So really, when I say you need to bypass the problems to come, let's put it in the proper perspective. What really will happen in a certain way is that those who want this scenario of loss, to engage in this scenario of loss, meaningful loss, will simply bypass you. They'll bypass you. They'll cut a big swath around you. They won't even get near. And when you have this attitude, perhaps what'll happen is this entire scenario of loss will bypass you. And you'll find yourself in the kingdom of heaven, as it were. You'll find yourself in the death-free world. Not so much as ascending to it, but as if the world simply flees from you. This whole scenario of loss just bypasses you entirely. And therein lies your safety. That is how I'm seeing it. Because it doesn't want to have anything to do with you. Nothing to do with you. And maybe there's something in us that our pride says, wait a minute, I don't want to be ignored. But I think you do want to be ignored with this scenario that's coming upon the world. I think you do want that to ignore you. Definitely. And being in a condition of unconditional love, total unconcern for any outcomes in a dream, that literally will cause them to bypass you big time. And the whole scenario will bypass you. And you will find yourself in a scenario that doesn't bypass you. And that scenario would be, I say, the death-free realm. There is such a place. There is such a place. There is an experience that seems like existence, but it's death-free realm. There's no harm there whatsoever. There's no loss taking place. The lot is a loss-free world. Literally, there's such a place. I've experienced it. And you just look around and you say, oh my gosh, nothing here has ever experienced any loss. There's never been loss take place here. And the feeling is fantastic. It's wonderful. You just feel like you can't even, I cannot even express it or explain it. It's some kind of gratitude, you know, an awakening. It's like an awakening gratitude and realization. The realization, you know, dawns that, wow, reality has never been harmed, has never been threatened in any way. And there's no loss that's ever taking place or can ever take place there. Now, there are those that in existence that believe that by thwarting the dark forces, that they are preventing the destruction of reality. So they feel that they're the real heroes. And so, okay, that's a perspective too. But that, you know, needs to be resolved. Is that true or not? If it were true, then of course you would want to participate in that and protect reality from destruction. But I would say that people are more frightened of waking up from the dream than they are of experiencing loss and destruction in the dream. Because they do believe that this dream is their new home and they have to try and fix it somehow. Make it inhabitable, make it nice, make it acceptable, make it comfortable. So, sort of the new paradigm that I'm talking about, that I'm seeing right now, is that being passed by. By the way, I think the Jewish holiday of celebration of Passover is very important. That sort of signifies that the blood of Christ signifies the attitude. See, in the ancients, they believed that blood literally contained the attitudes, the persona, the beliefs, the face, the attitudes in it. And so the blood of Christ would mean, or the blood of an innocent, like an innocent lamb, mean a peacefulness, means resist not evil. Nothing real can be threatened. Perfect defenselessness. The blood of so saved by the blood of Christ means saved by the attitude of perfect defenselessness. Okay, that's what it really means. And with that attitude, the entire scenario of loss literally passes you by. So that's the big Passover. It's not really an ascension, our transformation, our mutation, our shift at all. It's a Passover. That this entire scenario passes you over. All of it. And you find it. What are you left with? That which doesn't pass you over. And what is that? Loss-free scenario. Scenario that is not trying to generate loss. Because it says, welcome, welcome, welcome. There is no loss in reality. Get used to it. Here's a way to get used to it. So we're kind of bringing everything full circle here. Again, saved by the blood of Christ, which is the basic Christian profession, means saved by an attitude. Blood supposedly contains all the attitudes, and the blood of Christ means the blood of defenselessness. So accept that blood, meaning that attitude, and perfect defenselessness. Again, perfect love cast out all fear. Another way to say it is perfect love, fear completely bypasses it. Loss completely bypasses it. It doesn't want anything to do with it because it sees no opportunity there. None. Zero. And again, loss is purposeful. So when it sees no opportunity, forget it. It's not going to bother you one bit. It's going to bypass you. So the Jews in Egypt put the blood of a lamb, what they symbolized, defenselessness, pure innocence, pure defenselessness, as a lamb, okay, a beautiful young lamb. And then they used that blood of the lamb to symbolize that they accepted that innocence for themselves, that defenselessness. See, a lamb is very defenseless. It symbolizes defenselessness. That's why they say, Christians say, saved by the blood of the lamb. The lamb symbolizes defenselessness. The blood symbolizes that attitude that we have. We need to have that attitude within us, within the blood, as it were. And by having that, all harm, all loss, all the destructivity, that all passes us by. We experience the true Passover of these end times, which will happen. Jesus told us that it will happen. And it's not like the rapture. It's not. I don't think it's so much. I don't know how it's going to be symbolized, acted out, as it were, symbolically at this level. I'm not sure. Important thing is the principle, though. And the principle is, again, the Passover principle. Saved by the blood of the Lamb. Saved by the attitude of defenselessness. My perfect safety lies in my perfect defenselessness. Because we know reality cannot suffer loss, therefore it needs no defense. And so being completely unconcerned about loss, we find ourselves in a loss-free world, a world where there is no loss. Nothing can suffer loss. Not through some stratagem, but just simply because the entire scenario of loss bypasses it. We find ourselves in, like, paradise, really. It really is paradise. I mean, paradise is a place where there's no loss. Paradise is a reminder of reality, really. So I've always expected to find myself there one day. I've continued to hammer away at this truth as I see it. Not through effort, though. Not through stratagem, not through effort, but simply by realization that no results in a dream matter at all. All attempts to accomplish the impossible are equally futile. Reality needs no defense, etc., etc., etc. These attitudes, this blood, as it were, again, ancients symbolize attitudes as blood. Okay. So this blood, these attitudes are the beatitudes, almost as it were, of Christ. What is told to us how to be saved from this scenario that is coming upon this planet, which is very much coming upon this planet, is simply to have the entire thing pass you by. It automatically passes you by. When you have these attitudes, you don't need to do anything else. It will automatically pass you by. Where's Anandamayima now? The world passed her by. So, you know, so she appeared, her body appeared to die. She didn't go anywhere. The world demanded loss, you know, the traditional flow of loss, loss of body. So it passed her by, so it's unaware of her now. But she's still present. Jesus is still present. Those who have been saved, as it were, or who are always saved, are still present. We don't see him. We don't experience him because we're still enmeshed in this dream of loss, whereas they are not. They're not. The world passes them by. But we can also be passed by. And we don't even have to die for that to happen. Especially at this time. Because the scenario of loss will be so demanding. It'll be so crucial in this world now that there'll be this planetary sacrifice. That those who offer no defense and are completely unconcerned, defenseless, the lambs of Christ, as it were, who give no meaning to loss at all, who offer no meaning to loss. Loss will pass them by. The whole world will pass them by. Big time, right now. The world will just, the whole scenario will pass them by. Okay. And that is what people refer to as rapture, ascension, all this shifting, etc., etc. But it's not quite like that. I don't see it quite like that. It's more of a Passover. It's really more of a Passover. And you appear to vanish from their sight. You're no longer in their scenario at all. Their perception of you has passed over. The whole matrix has passed you over. I know the younger folks here grew up with the matrix. Okay, here's a way of putting it. The entire matrix passes you over at this point coming up soon. The entire matrix will pass you over and saying, I can't digest this one. I'll get indigestion if I try to eat this one up. So I better not do it. And it will just automatically flee from you, it'll push you over. And you won't be in oblivion or annihilation as it claims, because it thinks that this dream is all that there is. It's not. You will find yourself in paradise. You will find yourself in a death-free realm that is simply amazing. And I'm witness to this. I've been there. And you just look at a tree and you just this feeling builds up and you say, oh my gosh, this tree has never experienced loss of any kind. Nothing here. You look about, you just go from one thing to another. There's no loss. You say, holy cow, how beautiful, how wonderful. This reminds me of something. And you start thinking, wow, this really reminds me of something that I really want to be reminded of. And what it reminds you of is reality. So Jesus said, resist not evil. If you have the blood of Christ, it means resist not evil. Because you know all outcomes in a dream are equally meaningless. So what is there to resist? My perfect safety lies in my perfect defenselessness. And that results in perfect Passover by all entire scenario of destruction. And keep in mind that in order for destruction to occur, it has to be a duality, it has to be polarity, it has to be positive, negative, light and dark. Has to be something that stands for meaning, meaningful life, meaningful value. Loss can have a meaning. Loss can seem to have a meaning. If that isn't present, then if loss has no meaning, what kind of loss is that? It's no loss at all. You see, this dream is trying to get rid of reality, but so it has to feel it's meaningful, that actually reality actually was destroyed. But if reality doesn't resist at all, it seems meaningless, empty, empty. There's no loss experience there. That's how. So I'm seeing more and more that Jesus's teachings are truly correct and profound. Not that many Christians understand them, really. At some level, I think intuitively, they may have some intuitive attraction to them. But they may not entirely, really, clearly understand them, because so many of them are into this whole idea that evil must be met and defeated, which is completely opposite of what Jesus taught. Completely opposite. He said, resist not evil. Because when you resist not evil, it will bypass you. Because it will find nothing of value there. If you say, sure, take everything, it's nothing. It's absolutely nothing. Then they'll be horrified. Horrified. They say, I don't want you. You're nothing. I don't want nothing. I want the loss of something. And if you say, my appearance here is just nothing, it's nothing, then it'll bypass you. Doesn't want the loss of nothing. Doesn't want it. Can't stand it. And the whole scenario of loss, the good, the bad, and the ugly, will bypass you. You'll be passed over. And then in its place, you'll find yourself in the gentle arms of the loss-free world. Ananda Maimon said, we all have to eventually wind up in the death-free realms. And we can do that now. We literally can do that. Passover time is coming. And again, how this is acted out symbolically, I'm not sure. I'm not sure. We'll find out. The important thing is the attitude. It's the attitude. The blood, the attitude. Resist not evil. We can go over this. The videos here have been going over this and over and over and over and over it. And we're getting clearer and clearer and clearer as we go over it. And it's a great thing to go over this and to realize maybe there is a way. Maybe there is a way. And now we're seeing maybe, it's just not maybe, I think there is a way. There really is a way. It's not maybe. And we're just getting clearer about it. Saved by the blood of Christ, saved by the attitude that all outcomes in a dream are equally meaningless, all attempts to accomplish impossible, equally futile, and that nothing real is threatened, nothing unreal exists, and in perfect defenselessness lies my perfect safety. And as this attitude expands within us, as it were, purifies and becomes totally coherent, then our Passover is guaranteed. Our Passover is guaranteed. And if there is one that can come into the world with this pure attitude, this pure blood, as it were, blood of Christ, in other words, Christ meaning knowing reality cannot be threatened, totally certain of it, then that can start a chain reaction of Passover here, really. I expect it will happen. I'm not the one who's going to start it, that's for sure, because I don't have that coherence. I have a conceptual coherence that is getting stronger and stronger and stronger, which means it's kind of like the fruit is ripening. But, you know, like we have tomatoes on the vine, but if it's too cold, they're not going to turn red. They're going to ripen. You bring the heat, you know, you bring the real strong heat in the tomatoes, boom, they ripen up. You know, fruit needs some boost in order to ripen. We know that. We know that. So, there are ripe fruits. That's called the harvest. It's also called the harvest. There are many ripe fruits in the world who are ready to receive this boost and get coherence in their attitude of defenselessness. Resist not evil. In the most profound coherence of understanding and attitude, and then that will literally bring about their Passover. And that Passover could happen very soon indeed. Even during 2012 or the end of 2012, 2013, you know. Within these time frames, soon. I don't know exactly when. And maybe it will be a gradual thing. I mean, as each one becomes coherent in their attitude, that coherence, sudden gelling, crystallizing that attitude, then the Passover will happen for them. And then when another becomes coherent in that attitude, the Passover will happen for them. And so fruits will ripen, you know, maybe at slightly different times. And maybe one that is perfectly coherent, maybe there's some way for them to remain in this world, their parents to remain here to help others get this coherence of crystallization too. And then there may be a group Passover where many are passed over at the same time. Again, it's not just a destructive sword wielding, you know, the bad guys who are, they're wielding a lot of bad stuff for sure. It's not just them, it's the entire scenario of loss, which involves the good, the bad, and the ugly. Destruction can't be meaningful at all unless there's something that it believes is destroying. So let's say someone wants to destroy a tree. Well, it first has to be, a tree has to grow first, right? And then people have to say, oh, I love that tree so much. This is my favorite tree. If I ever lost that tree, it'd be terrible. And then in come the beetles, you know, and they bore into the tree. And they one day people go out to the tree and they say, oh, good morning, my precious tree, the tree I love so much. Thank you for being here. So blessed. And I say, well, what is that on the end of your branches there? What is that? It looks like deadness or something. And they start getting all worried. And gradually, bit by bit, the tree dies in front of them. And dying takes a couple years, you know. Sometimes trees die slowly, and they frantically try all sorts of things. Nothing works. And they experience this dreadful loss, this dreadful sense of loss. But who do you think is jumping up and down and celebrating? Those who believe in the whole dynamic of loss is celebrating that. It takes two to tango. See, it takes the tree, and it takes those who are worshiping the tree and feeling that the loss of the tree would be devastating because they love it so much, and then it takes the loss of the tree, destruction of it, and then that brings about a quote-unquote meaningful loss, at least the appearance of such. But if, let's say, there was a beautiful tree and one went out there and said, you know, tree, whether you are here or not here, whatever may be the case, it doesn't affect me in the slightest bit. Because I realize there's no such thing as loss at all. I already see you in your lossless form. So whether your appearance is unimportant. And so those who want to just, you know, come in to destroy, they say, wait a minute. If I destroy this tree, nobody cares. So where's the loss? There's no loss. Not causing any dismay or feeling of loss at all. So they're going to say, ah, to heck with that. So the real world, the loss-free world, is based on this attitude of defenselessness. It's based on the realization it's all an appearance. And that loss is impossible. Loss of the real is impossible. And therefore, it's based on that attitude entirely. And it cannot be harmed. It's passed over. Harm is passed over because the way that it is such that there would not be anything meaningful take place. And so it's that which cannot be touched. Cannot be touched. It's hard to explain. I have to admit, it's at this point, right now, at this very moment, I'm not able to give a completely coherent explanation of it. But you can get a sense of it. Like, let us say that, again, the one who looked at a tree, the appearance, was not threatened by its loss in the slightest bit. Then loss would pass over that tree, and that tree would be without any loss whatsoever. Let's say there's a whole world that way, where the realization was that the loss of this world would not be any loss at all. Loss of appearance is no loss at all. Loss of reality, and the real cannot be lost, then that whole world would be passed over by loss. Loss wouldn't even touch it. It'd be meaningless to loss. So that real world is an appearance. It's an appearance. Yes, it's an appearance. It's not real, it's an appearance. It's like a mirage. It's an illusion, but it's a beautiful illusion. There's no loss in that illusion. It's like a whole world, a whole domain that's been passed over. That's there. I've been there. It is there. And I've been working for so long to figure out how to get there. And now I see it's this Passover principle. It's this defenseless principle. It's a realization that loss of appearance is no loss at all. Loss of an illusion is not a loss. It's just not evil. That attitude then enables this entire domain, its appearance, to be there and no loss take place whatsoever. You realize it's an appearance, but it's a halfway house. It's a beautiful appearance. It's a halfway house from which you're able to then function in reality, be fully present in reality, completely present, as it were, and function the way you're created to function. It enables that because you get this feeling. It reminds you. It's a reminder of reality, of no loss, no loss, and reality doesn't need to be defended, because this domain has no defense. It doesn't defend itself at all, and so loss has to pass it by. Because it says, my gosh, there's nothing here to attack because there's no defenses. How could there be anything to attack? And how could the attack be meaningful if there's no defenses? Cannot. Lost scenario cannot, has to leave that alone. It has to leave it alone. So there's this entire domain that is left alone by loss, by attack, automatically. And you can literally dwell in that domain. And there's no... You don't need to defend yourself at all. Nothing needs to be defended there. It's fabulous. That's the quote-unquote the world that Christ went to prepare for us. And where he said that he'll come back and take us to the place that he's prepared for us. That is that domain. It's automatically passed by. Because loss sees absolutely no meaning in attacking it. None. And again, loss cannot attack what is meaningless to attack. It cannot do that. It's not able to do that. Cannot. That's why Jesus says perfect defenselessness is total safety. Loss cannot attack perfect defenselessness. It cannot. That's why you hear these apocryphal talks about throughout history of how saints and sages and gurus could walk amid the most severe danger, and nothing touches them. Nothing touches them. You know, they could be walking through a severe battle where everybody's dying all around them, and mayhem is occurring, and they have no defenses, no weapons, nothing. They could just be sitting there, walking, and nothing would touch him. Nothing. That is true. That is truth. That is truth. We're getting to the core of truth. Getting to the core of truth. We're getting to the core of safety. We're getting to the core of salvation here. I really feel it. And it's unexpected. It was kind of like, wow. It's just kind of unexpected. Just, I don't know how I came up with this. The cohesion suddenly came. This is profound, and not a minute too soon, because the Olympics are going on. The Olympics are exercise let us not even say it. It's the opposite of Passover, I'll tell you that. It's the whole idea of inculcating a sense of preciousness and the belief that we need to protect everything. Protect appearance. Protect symbols. Universe is symbolic. It's nothing but symbols. Energy is symbolic. Nothing but symbols. Doesn't need to be protected. Why do we need to protect symbols? Why? Why? And why? We don't need to. That realization, we don't need to protect symbols. Enables the Passover, and you'll find yourself in paradise. the thief or murderer on the cross with Jesus said, ah, just before he died, he said, ah, oh, I get it. I get it now. I see you're not even resisting at all. And he got it. And Jesus says, this very moment you'll be with me in paradise, guaranteed. And that's what happened. This one that died on the cross with him is in paradise now, in the death-free realm. Whereas the other one was screaming, why don't you save yourself? Why don't you resist? Why don't you resist? We're losing something valuable here, you know. That one is still, you know, struggling in this loss-based scenario of existence. What is real can't be threatened. And what is unreal doesn't exist. It isn't, you know, it's just a symbol. So therefore nothing real, nothing can be threatened. Therein lies the peace of God. Therein lies the peace of God. And if you're watching this, congratulations. I told you'd be better than watching the Olympics, because the whole blueprint for salvation has been made pretty plain here. Finally. And it ties in with the great traditions. Doesn't reject them. Just clarifies them. And that's a great thing too. I've always said that Jesus, for me, is the best teacher, really. Understand what you're talking about, but it's coming into focus now. And then I've always said Ananda Maima is the best example in the world we've had in modern times of this defenselessness. Embodied the advice perfectly. And we have, you know, pictures and video and all this stuff. We can look at it, which is very helpful. And realize, wow, it's possible. It really can. Amazing attitude. He says, let whatever come, come. I'm not trying to choose anything at all. Whatever wants to come, come. I'm not resisting anything. I'm not asking for anything. Not resisting it, not asking for anything. Everything is equally welcome to come. She'd even have illnesses come, and she wouldn't resist them at all. She'd get sick. And it didn't affect her at all as far as her attitude. And then after a while, the illnesses would just leave. She said, I didn't bring them to me. Nor did I ask them to leave. She said, they came, they played here for a while, and then they left. Amazing things happened with her, what we'd call miracles. She had cancer, severe cancer. I think it was some kind of liver cancer or something, metastasized throughout her whole body. Just her whole body was just absolutely horribly afflicted with it. And the doctor on her treatment of MD, and she just said, I don't need any treatment. Everything will be fine. I don't care one way or the other. Whether I live or die makes no difference. And the doctor, the doctor was sure she was going to die that night because her breathing was affected. I mean, literally, the tumors were everywhere in her body and affecting her throat. She could hardly breathe, and the doctor felt that at least he could give her a shot of morphine to ease the pain, and she refused all drugs, all treatment. And this is something that's chronicled. There are doctors and you know, intelligentsia and responsible people witnessing this situation. They're very, very much aware of it. And everyone thought that she was going to die within a matter of a few days. And so the doctor at nighttime snuck in and wanted to give her a shot of morphine or opium derivative while she was sleeping. But before he could get there, he saw her sitting upright, and he saw a flash of light, bright flash of light, and then he saw some figure, like some kind of monkey figure, leap out of the room over the veranda toward the Ganges and disappear. And he ran back to his room, you know, shaking and trembling. He was so distraught. What he had seen, it just freaked him out. He went there in the morning, and he saw Ananda Maima, and there was not a trace of cancer anywhere in her body. It had vanished overnight, literally, all of it. And it's just like he was just undone. You know, it was just unbelievable. And he said, "What happened?" And she said, "Well, the plague of cancer, my body decided to leave me at that time. So again, I didn't call it to me. I didn't ask it to leave. When it wanted to leave, I didn't have any resistance to it leaving. And poof, it left like that, gone. All of it." She says, "Illnesses have a form. They're like a life form, so to speak. They have a type of form, subtle form. And that form can, if we don't resist it leaving, it can leave instantaneously." And so, you know, many stories like that of all different kinds that we would say is totally miraculous. Because she resisted not evil at all. She didn't resist anything. Saw no difference among appearances here. No difference. Again, all illusory. Everything is equally illusory. All illusions are equally unreal. All illusions are equally unreal. And she was a perfect example of that. So, you know, I came across this example and I said, "Wow, that's very helpful to see that." Very, very helpful indeed. And then this helps with the Passover, realizing we can. This is the truth. This is real. The blood of Christ is the way. In other words, this attitude. All illusions are equally unreal. Nothing real needs any defense. All attempts to accomplish the impossible are equally futile. I don't need to judge or differentiate among any of them. That is the same attitude of Passover, meaning no judgments are needed, none. So why participate in any scenario at all of loss? Either triumphing over loss or being affected by loss. Either one. Then the whole thing has to bypass you. It has to. So I wonder what's going to happen with me at this point. I really do. I've been in the exact same place for 50 years. Exact same place. It's just like I've been like sitting on this bench for 50 years. Almost literally. In the same place. And at some point, you know, this place could pass me by. That's possible. It's really possible. I may find myself in another place very soon. Maybe in this world, possible, but maybe in a different place. I have to say it's possible. It is possible now. Now that I see the principle, what's going on, if this attitude crystallizes in me, this realization crystallizes, I may really find myself in a different place after 50 years of being in the same place. Because not through any effort of my own, it's simply that the lot will be passing me by, and that will just result in finding myself in a different place, perhaps in a much more even beautiful place than this. This is a exceedingly beautiful place where I am now. It's not that I would want to leave it, because I love it. It's an incredibly nice place. It's just about ideal, you know. But I may find myself in some place even better, as it were. I don't know. Or simply the whole scenario bypassing and finding myself in paradise. It's not a joke. Now that I see the principle, I realize, yeah, this is for real. This is true. This is really true. This Passover teaching is really true. Kudos to those who understand this, who really understand it. Wow. That's really profound. It's the most profound teaching. Some of those great saints, wow. They really knew the truth. Very profound. They're most certainly in paradise, the lost free realm. And we most certainly will join them there. No doubt about it. Wonderful, wonderful. So, again, not watching the Olympics and watching this has its benefits, right? If you watch the Olympics, we get to see somebody swimming, you know, in a swimming pool. Whatever. But you're not going to find out about salvation. No, you're not. In fact, you're going to be distracted from it. Very much distracted from it. So, this is great. Who knows? I may make another video. Very possible. Let's keep this one at a manageable level so somebody will watch it. But coming on strong. I'll come on strong. Keep coming on strong here. This is great stuff. Really enjoy this effort. I've enjoyed making these efforts because it's supremely helpful for me. And I can't help but imagine that somehow it's going to be helpful for others down the line. Okay? All right. That's it for this video.